Thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Ursula Schmid-Erfurt, to be here in Vienna again. I lived here 6 years, and talking about the future, if you look at this building, I think people who constructed this building were also futurists. We look at today as something very old-fashioned, but I think at the time where they were constructing these buildings, these people were very progressive. And I think we always forget about that when we talk about conservation, that a lot of the things that we conserve were created by futurists. There was a book Robin Hanson wrote that I read this year. It's called The Age of EM. And it's about how the world will look like in 100 years. And that means when perhaps our brains get emulated in a robot and we don't all work, and it's a very scary book. It's one specific scenario. And in the beginning of that book, he mentioned that if you do a search on Amazon and you look at the number of books that are available about history, you come about 99.5% of the books are about history and 0.5% are about the future. And I think we have to, with all the technology and all the changes that are now happening, I think we have to focus ourselves way much more on the future, because there's so much things that are going to change. I know that we have been saying that as an IT industry, but I will hope and try to convince you that we will need to embrace and cooperate and collaborate to design this future so it's a desirable future and not a dystopian future. I always talk about there's a dystopia and there's a utopia, and I try to create a mytopia. So, and that's the future that we all want to live in. And before I start, I'm going to talk about a personal story. I was working for IBM on a project that we have a corporate citizenship team, and we can spend our time like 3 months, 6 months on philanthropic projects. And I was working for the World Health Organization, more specifically for the IARC, that's the International Agency for Cancer Research, or Research on Cancer. And they have a program where they want to build cancer registries for mid and low income countries. This is how an IBM looks like when it goes to Africa. But I was meeting the ministries of health, and we were trying to see what we could do, and we wanted to spend hardware, infrastructure, software to start building these cancer registries. And I was very motivated, but then when you look at the reality there and you then discover that in some specific countries you have 6 pathologists in the whole country, and you go to a hospital and you see there is, in each ward or ward, there is a specific record of the same patient, there is no digital record. The patients, they admit themselves in the hospital with a false name because the person that lives in Nairobi, the family, is the one who is registered. The one who lives 3,000 kilometers or 300 kilometers away is not registered. So when he dies and you want to talk about survival rates, you can't even map that because he was registered with a false name. So it's really frustrating. And then if you look at the prevalence of the most important form of cancer is cervical cancer. And then if you look at we know that the Pap smear, that this is the golden standard to test the HPV infection, it costs $20. But it is just not feasible in a lot of countries to implement a test because there's no labs, there's no pathology, there's no infrastructure. And then if you know that the therapy costs $24 to treat or to prevent, and you know that it takes 20 years between infection and the development of cervical cancer, then we kind of think that this is a tragedy. And then I left after 3 months, wrote a report. I was completely frustrated because there was nothing you could actually do with technology there. And then you ask yourself the question, can they leapfrog? Can they do things differently? And I'm going to come back to this example later, because we have found then, oh, there is a solution to this problem that they have. And my talk of today will be divided in different parts. I'm going to go more into the area of, okay, what is happening in the area of machine learning on data science. And then I will jump into what I call the economics around data science and AI, because I think that's where the biggest change will happen. And we call that the platform economy. And I will make some provocative statements, and I hope at the end we still have some time for questions and discussions, because I said we need a larger dialogue on these things. And I know that in this room there are a lot of experts that are already working with deep learning. We as IBM, we started 6 years ago working with Jeopardy, proving that we could use NLP. I wrote in 1989 a paper at school about artificial intelligence because my uncle was an IT person in a bank and he was using expert systems. There's nothing new about artificial intelligence. The only thing that is new is that we have the computing power, we have the amount of data, and we have an incredible amount of research being spent on that technology. And we just see in the last 5 years extreme changes in the, for example, recognition rates. When we 5 years ago we could classify a cat and a dog in the internet, well, we can now work on specific diagnostics and we are getting very accurate at it. And we are seeing that machines are being able to see better than humans do, and I will give some examples later. The same thing with speech recognition. We have a lot of data through our iPhones, through our smartphones. Being able to access that data helps us to create better speech recognition rates and with the application of deep learning. We all know that from talking to our smartphone or perhaps a home device that we will be able to talk to computers. And one of the projects I've been working on is the keyboardless hospital, because I believe that the keyboard will be eliminated as a form factor and that IT and technology will be pervasive and we will get a very different interaction with machines, which is very needed in a hospital. If you look at the amount of time spent on a desktop today by nurses and by physicians. I find this is there is a report. It's called the Artificial Intelligence Index. It's sponsored by Stanford. They started looking in the number of publications. If you look what happened in the last 5 years, the number of AI papers within computer science have tenfolded the number of publications. There is, as I said before, an incredible amount of interest. And there is an incredible amount of spend from the private sector as well. In that specific area. And if you then, there was some quotes that I mentioned. If you look at what happened last year, there was from a Google scientist that said, like, we can now use neural networks that are 5 to 10 times cheaper and use a lot of less features as we did last, or as we had last year. So on a year-to-year basis, we see so incredibly amount of change. And we will see that even the capacities, the iPhone X, the last version, had a mobile deep learning processor as a mobile capability. So we will see a lot of these capabilities being decentralized. We will get access to very cheap algorithms that will allow us to do even more of these incredible innovations or drive these innovations. And then, so deep learning in a sense is not, the progression is not linear, so it's the successes and the breakthroughs are actually the sum of the parts that was published before. And that's what you see, for example, with Shabta. You all know that when you go on the internet and you have to prove that you are a human and you're not a robot, and they do this mostly, for example, I get really frustrated when I book a ticket for a concert, because we know that it's open, the offices are online open at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and two minutes later, it's already sold out. And mostly these are robots behind it, and then they try to create these tools that you have to prove that you are human. Well, now there is what they call the recursive cortical network, and they are performing better than humans. So even the tool that we have to prove that we are humans is now being kind of hacked or being done better by algorithms. So what I see in the discussions that I always have is that we as humans, we get really excited and we think that in 1 year all this AI is going to do all these great things. No, it's not. It's still not there. It's not so as precise. But what we do also as a human are really bad in is really thinking what is 10 years ahead. If you look 10 years, we just had a smartphone. There was like 750,000 healthcare apps being developed in 10 years. We have new professions. It's called a UX designer, an app designer that you can learn on the university. In 10 years, so many things happened. If you would have asked that 10 years ago, what the future would look like, nobody would have expected that this change would come so rapidly. And a lot of this change is exponential. And we are very good in linear thinking. But if I ask you, okay, take one step, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, and I ask you where you're going to be when you take 30 steps, that gets a lot difficult because you're going to walk one time across the planet if you take these steps. So thinking exponentially as a human is very difficult. And the technology, and we call these exponential technologies, are growing at an exponential rate. One of these technologies being launched, IBM just launched a cloud-based 20-qubit computer, so a quantum computing, and next year we're going to be able to, we have now a prototype, we're going to be able to make as a general available a 50-qubit processor. That means 2 power 50 quadrillion states that the computer can have. And it's a bit, quantum computing is a bit difficult to understand, but the most easiest thing to solve a problem, if you look at computers, if they want to find a solution in a maze, then the computer will try to calculate all possible combinations or possibilities, and then at the end, he will find then the solution. But with a quantum computing, he will just do that one push on a button and he will find the answer. That's the difference, because he has all these different states, and the 50 qubit is way over the supercomputing power that we have today. So add that to the availability of deep learning algorithms, availability of data that will be available, the sensor data, add these things all together, and we will see even a quicker acceleration in the discoveries. Do we need AI for that? I found this really an interesting study. Well, image recognition is not only something that humans have been doing, but there was this very interesting study where they used pigeons, and these pigeons were able to recognize cancer tissue as good as human expert did. It's a very interesting study, but I think the problem with a pigeon is that you can't scale it, and you need to train it. The difference between a pigeon and an AI and a deep learning algorithm is that, and that's what fascinates me on the possibilities, is that once you have that algorithm and that solution, you can scale it. You can scale it through the globe because you have access to cloud, you have access to mobile, you make that knowledge available. If you want to scale a pigeon, you need to train them all. It's very difficult to scale. And it all started and I'm going to go a bit in the human versus machines factor. We always did, and there was IBM in 1996, where we have beaten Garry Kasparov. It always started to see how machines are doing very difficult tasks, and I was watching this live in 1996, and it was like a huge phenomenon, but if you tell it our kids, and then you say like, well, there was a computer that has beaten Garry Kasparov, they don't look excited. They think it's normal because the iPhone can do that. But what is actually interesting today is that the competition is not humans versus machines, it's human and machine versus machines, and what we tend to see is that the human and the machine always is winning most of the time versus the machine. So there is a new kind of competition where you bring machines and humans and you augment humans with machines or machine intelligence, and they are beating the machines. The same thing with natural language processing, because chess is a very structured game. You have a limited amount of possibilities. But what is it with language? Once you start understanding language, you can tap into the knowledge bases, and you can create a system that actually can do question answering and tap into all the knowledge available. Then Google with AlphaGo. AlphaGo, it was the predictor that in 2028, they were going to beat that. Well, it happened 10 years earlier. So we can't even predict anymore when these things will happen, but this was something that was predicted, but they predicted it would happen in 2028. And everything what we see now happening is based on machine learning. I'm not going to go into depth. I think there are way more or better experts into the technology part of it, or in depth part of it. But I'm going to give you some examples of where machine learning is being used. It's all about visual recognition at the moment, because it's a very limited problem, and you don't have the problem about the data bias. So we did it with IBM Research. We developed a tool, and there are many, Stanford, there are others doing this as well, where we use deep learning algorithms evidence that we can, with a very high confidence, detect melanoma screening for a zero price and completely automated. What you actually use for that is and what we call these convolutional neural networks or ensemblers, and this will always evolve. We now have a 95% area under the curve accuracy, and you will see this improving the more data we will get. The very interesting thing is, this is a project that we did with Memorial Sloan Kettering, is that we only needed 3,000 images to get that accuracy. So it's not always about big data, it's about having smart data, very good quality curated data, because if you're going to use all the data available, you're going to get an average physician or an average AI. You want to get the expert data, you want to get working with the experts. And as we are playing games in AI, I allowed myself to play a bit of Pong. So the computer is overperforming with the humans in that sense in recognizing melanoma. You see the same thing on the pathology. You see lung cancer tissue being better recognized by computers as the average pathologist. You see that as well, as, and I don't have to explain it, this is IDX that published these studies. And you can see that in all areas. And you see these studies being published in only the last 24 months. And I think that is just the start of everything what we will see. And people are very skeptical, and they say, like, no, it's not going to happen well. And we have our rules and our guidelines. And even if you then look at this study, that was from a research study where they used deep learning algorithms, and with all the challenges they are. But they looked at what deep learning in terms of features and prediction capabilities delivered versus the golden standard from the American Heart Association. And there was a group of 380,000 patients, 10 years longitudinal data, and the deep learning algorithm was able to find out about 22 more data points, and they were able to do better predictions as the golden standards did. I'm not going to go into detail because that study can also be a bit biased, but I think it's just a matter of time where we will see that knowledge and guidelines will be created out of deep learning and not by experts. And there's been a lot of discussions about the black box medicine, because a deep learning algorithm, you can't really, how do you say that, explain how the decision was taken. I will say it in that way. But if you look at an expert, and I'm going to be very provocative, but if you look at how guidelines are being defined today, well, these are expert opinions in some sense. And I don't know if a professor in that expert opinion group is biased or not. And I think seen with Watson, we have developed knowledge-based systems working on NCCN guidelines for cancer care. And then you come into Germany, and then you notice that there are other guidelines. And then suddenly I feel like being Game of Thrones, and every kingdom has its own knowledge kingdom. And then you start building systems. And I think there's a lot of challenges that we need to overcome, because it's at the end, who is defining the truth? And that's going to be a very strong discussion. And I think this is not technological. This is very political, what needs to be done, and how we to solve these issues. And then these systems start to see things that we don't even see. So they used functional MRIs, and then they tested these patients, gave them patients. And there was a control group here that they gave them keywords like dead and dying or negative words, and then they could see all these dysfunctional MRIs that they could predict suicidal tendencies, which wasn't something that they haven't seen before. So you will see that these algorithms are going to be used to create new knowledge. And this is probably something that is going to accelerate. If you look at the speed of applying new knowledge in the healthcare system, somebody said to me once, it takes 17 years from the first hypothesis to implementing a large scale. I think what we will see is that the time of discovery to implementation will dramatically shorten. And I think what we will see, if we use all the data that is available today, that the discoveries that we make out of the data will have a larger impact than any other drug that was brought to market in the last 20 years. And this is a quote that I always use, because, and it's very provocative, but and I think 10 years from now is a really long time, knowing that we have access to next year to a 50 quad-bit quantum computing computer. We have this year in the States 6.8 billion on venture capital investment on digital health. if you see what is happening, it is I'm very confident to say that in 10 years from now, probably 80% of the classified diagnosis today, the algorithms will overperform physicians. So does that mean that IT is going to destroy us and you hear all these dystopian views? No, I think as mentioned before with the chess game, there was a very good study from Beth Israel, the Econ Center and Harvard Medical School. When you let humans and algorithms work together, and the algorithm here had an error on the curve from it was like 85%, or no, it was like about 82%, I think, in this study. But actually, the humans were performing better, but together they nearly reached 100% accuracy. And I think there is a lot of hope I see when it's not about man versus machine, but it's human and machine versus disease at the end. And I think we need to embrace this. We don't need to fight it. It's going to happen anyway. And I think there are a lot of chances to perhaps redefine the value in healthcare. Now, coming back to my story from Africa. So I was very frustrated when I left. And I said, like, okay, but what can we do there? Do we need to build a lab? Do we need to build pathology centers? And then I went to India because I heard that there was a Dr. Dixit who had a cancer registry in Mumbai, and he didn't use pap smear, and he was able to build a cancer registry for cervical cancer. And then he told me that he used this very basic test where they use an acid that they put on the cervix and they get a visual reaction, they train nurses, and there is a visual reaction that you don't need a lab. And they showed me images, and he had like 200 of these images that they trained the nurses with. Well, now there is a company, because I gave and I connected Dr. Dixit, who had the images, with a startup of people that I knew in Israel. And there is now a company that it's Mobile ODT that is using this now as the golden standard in Africa in four countries. It's also being used in San Salvador, in developing countries. And it isn't as accurate yet, but we all know that these cameras, that these are exponential technologies, the resolution of these cameras will get better. We're going to get deep learning processing capacities within the smartphone, and we will see there is going to be an evolution. So it's just a matter of time until these devices will get as accurate as the golden standard, which today is the pap smear test. So what actually is happening here is what we call disruption. And we always, this word is overused, I know, but it was Clayton Christensen from Harvard Business School that actually started to use that. What is disruption? That is mostly when you have a new technology that does something way cheaper, way faster, way more convenient. And this is actually what's happening here. So you have something that used to cost $20 and it was too expensive because you have in sub-Saharan Africa 1 billion, a population of 1 billion people. In 2050, there's going to be 2 billion people living there. So you need to do things differently. And in Africa, they didn't have banks. They started with mobile banking. They didn't have landlines on telephone. They started with mobile phones. And I think what the opportunity, and that's why I advise a lot of startups, is that there is a lot of opportunity to test new technology and to get access to data if you can start bringing that technology, because it's not as good as our golden standard, it is not as accurate, but at least it is delivering value for the system, and we know that over time, the more data we will collect, we will be able to develop solutions that actually, if you look at healthcare, will serve 70% of the world population that today doesn't have access. We spend $6 trillion in healthcare, on healthcare, and 70% of the world population doesn't have access to the same service quality that we have. And I think there's a tremendous opportunity here for us in Europe and worldwide, because we can scale these solutions. Like it's an API, a web service that you can put through a mobile phone, you can use it as a PayPal service, and you can scale that in endless dimensions. And I think there's a huge opportunity for us here to scale the knowledge out of Europe, out of Vienna, out of our research institutes, and deliver that to the front of where it's most needed. But I used to say before that 80% of the today's classified diagnosis will overperform, because I think the biggest change that we will see in healthcare is when we start connecting system biology and AI, and we start looking at what's going to happen there, because our healthcare is a bit like the myth of the blind and the elephant. If you put five blind people to an elephant, the one behind would say, like, this is a rope. He would say, this is a tree. He would say, this is a wall. And he would say, this is a spear. But nobody would say, it's an elephant. And I think it's a bit similar like medicine, because this would be the urologist, this would be the orthopedic surgeon, and this would be the dermatologist, and this would be the dentist. And we don't look at healthcare as in a very holistic approach. And if we start understanding the systems of biology, the systems of how our body work, and I think that's where we see a lot of change, is the sequencing a genome in 3 years from now is going to cost $100. And we see these new data layers coming up on a transcriptome, a proteome, and a metabolome level that actually have an impact on our body, and we can start analyzing how our body as a system works. And then we will be able to find new biomarkers, understand pathways, and create system knowledge. To make that a bit more explicit, there was Leo Hood. I don't know if you're familiar with Leo Hood. He opened a center in Luxembourg with 100 million of funding, and his goal is really to make these pathways of diseases very visible, because what we actually focus on in healthcare is as soon as we have clinical signs, but perhaps we can look at it very earlier stages. And this is what actually is going to happen. We will be able to see out of the knowledge that we create, applying machine learning on these new data layers to early detect cancer, early detect diseases, and be able to influence it by supplementation, by lifestyle changes, by other kind of medication or prevention that you will use. So this is a bit of a provocative question, but medicine has always been a clinical science supported by data, but is medicine really about to become a data science supported by clinicians? And that's a question that we need to ask. And I think if you look at what actually I said before on the system biology level, I truly believe that humans are not even capable of understanding the data and getting these insights out of the data. So how do we put it into practice? I'm a huge fan of science fiction movies. This is a tricorder of Star Trek. You scan over the body and then you get the diagnosis, you get the treatment. Is this going to be the future? I'll give you a few examples. Well, we did with IBM Research. We developed a lab on chip. It can analyze 50 different proteins in 5 minutes with only a single blood drop. And I think that's what we're going to see. We're going to see a non-invasive test. There is a startup in Berlin that already has a patch. It takes minimal invasive. It analyzes your blood, and it delivers and supplies supplementation. It is supplementation, but it delivers and supplies it at home based on your readings. There is another startup here that's called Bowhead. I call it an espresso machine. So it actually uses these diagnostic lateral flow assays to do specific tests. And then it uses blockchain technology to have then specific gels. They call it here region spherical gels, but actually supplementation. And in the future, we will perhaps be able to think that we will do a quick test, a non-invasive test to check our health, that we get a smoothie that is being produced, that is being based on our data, health data, that will prevent diseases. That is what came out a few weeks ago. Mayan Oxford Nanopore, $1,000, a portable DNA sequencer. As I said before, these technologies are getting exponential. They're getting cheaper, they're getting smaller, they're getting decentralized. You don't need a large infrastructure anymore. You can get these tools at home, and that will change a lot. And I think we need to embrace this and try to, for ourselves, try to reconfigure healthcare. How do we implement it, and how do we make use of these technologies? I don't believe that the patient will be the person that will use all these technologies. I still think there is a very strong place for the physician, but if we don't embrace this, then we will get a very different system, because then it will get rationalized. So in a summary, I think what we will see is that we will go away from the conventional medicine that is focused on symptoms, that data is going to be the layer that we're going to take our decisions on. We're going to be allowed to do a continuous testing instead of episodic testing. It's not going to be based on the bell curve, population-based. It's going to be very individual, the therapies. It's not going to be rule-based, it's going to be algorithm-based, and the delivery is going to be through networks, and it's not going to be centralized. I call the hospital today a bit like a mainframe of the 60s, and now I have the mainframe capacities in my smartphone, and decentralized. And I think this is similar, but I think what is going to happen, we need to look at a decentralization, and as once the general surgeon said in the US, well, we need to do that because healthcare is not in taking care in the doctor's office. It's there where we eat, where we work, and where we pray. That's where we define healthcare, but we don't define our health in the hospital and in the doctor's office. So this was the first part to just give you a bit of a feeling what is actually happening on the market, and it's really going fast. But I want to go into something that is really concerning and we should think about, because you can look at these technologies, you can say like, well, we can build a wall, and we built like China did, a firewall around China, and you don't allow these services to come, and we're going to protect and conserve. But if you look what we really are doing, I can talk about Switzerland, Austria, and Germany. We have been talking about e-health and building electronic health records since over 10 years. It was about building bridges, it was about defining interoperability standards, it was about sharing. And in these 10 years, I haven't seen anybody that showed me his patient record where all of his data is being centralized. None of these projects has been successful. These projects were also wrongly set up. I thought these are transformation projects, and you can't then ask physicians to say, like, you have to buy that system, and then you need to share your data, but at the same time, you're gonna earn less money, and because you can't be able to do double testing anymore because you have to use that information, but you're gonna be more liable because you're gonna share that information. So all these questions that were there were not answered. And I think a lot of these e-health programs have been completely set up in a wrong way, because it's not an IT project, it is a transformation project. So the future is not about building networks. The future is about building a platform. And why do I believe so strongly that platforms are the solution to grow? Well, because we are in the age of AI. And if you look at the growth of platforms and you look at social media, Facebook is probably at the moment the largest cohort on mental data for mental diseases. They have 2 billion on users. They took 4 years and 6 months to get on the first 100 million users. Well, WhatsApp has 1.2 billion, and they took 3.5 years, then Instagram took less. And then Pokemon Go only needed 2 months to reach 100 million users. And there was a very good study that Pokemon Go, which is a ridiculous tool, but Pokemon Go, they managed to let people in specific areas walk 1,400 steps more because they could measure it with the bracelets they were wearing, because they had these Fitbits and these step counters, and there was an impact on their lifestyle. I think none of the ministries of health was able to do that. But Pokemon Go was able to, in a short time, to scale and to bring a solution or to bring a toy to the people. In a two-month period, they reached a population that is larger than Germany. So do we think then still we need to interconnect and define interoperability standards? No, it's about building platforms. And there is something what we call the platform economy. So all these startups like Uber is a platform, it's the largest transportation company, but they don't own a single car. Airbnb is a platform, they're one of the largest accommodation services providers, but they don't own a single house or hotel. So all of these platforms are using a specific business model, and if you look at the capitalization or the validation of these platforms companies, then I don't find Europe back, and Europe looks a bit like the sunken continent, and that scares me when I think about healthcare, when I think about specific industries that are important, where we have a very different ethical values, and that's why I'm connected to the Ethical Commission in Germany, because I think we need to start playing the games in the same group but with different rules, but we need to get our act together, and otherwise we're going to get dependencies here. And you don't see any single health company. And now there was last week an announcement. They were the first two unicorns in health in China and wanted a validation of $3.6 billion. We can laugh with it, but I remember that people laughed with me when 8 years ago I was buying stocks of Amazon. Well, they grew tenfold in the last year, and Amazon is now a profitable company. At the time when I bought them, they were in a state where they were just burning money, and people were laughing. It's like, this is a bubble, this is going to burst. It is not going to burst. A lot of these companies are not going to burst. They're going to start steadily grow. If you speak German, I didn't translate it because it's a quote. Holger Schmidt is a journalist for the Handelsblatt, and he has a very good website on platform economy, Netz economy. And if you look at today's state, Amazon, Apple, Alphabet, and Microsoft together, they have double as much worth as the whole DAX in Germany together. And that should be a wake-up call for all of us, because if you look at healthcare, well, healthcare is with us delivered by our social infrastructure, but if we don't lead anymore in this new economy, then how are we going to finance that? So I think we need to look at what is happening on the board level, and then the Bitkom in Germany did a survey, and they questioned the most 100 validated companies in Germany, and 6 out of 10 CEOs and the members of the board and never heard about the platform economy. And this is a survey from this year. This is, for me, very scary if you think about how quickly the world is changing. And it has to do with our culture, it has to do with our hierarchical organizations, people that, and McKinsey makes a very good remark on that, people that have never used a tweet or tweeted something in the world or never posted something on social media should not define a digital strategy because they don't understand the tools they are using. And if they want, then they need to get an assistant that is below 30 years old because they think very differently. And I think that's one of the things what we look at in Germany is that everything is very hierarchical. People in members in the board are in a certain age group, and I think that we need to be very more open and listening to what a lot of other people are telling, because the platform economy does 4 specific things. So it's going to commodify, or there's going to be a commodification, and it's going to optimize. There's going to be something is called, I'm going to go deeper into that, network effects, which will lead to an information asymmetry. First, commodification. I was on holding a keynote with the CEO of the largest private provider, or one of the largest private providers in Europe, and he was explaining how their revenues grew to 7.5 billion, and then at the same time, he was showing how his the number of employees grew. And then he was explaining 30 minutes how successful they digitalized. And then I asked him the question, where's the digitalization effect? Because that is not a digitalization strategy. A digitalization strategy is when you have a digital product, a service that does something automized and that you can scale, and then suddenly the transaction costs go down, you get a volume business, and then you get your revenues goes up. And that's what you call these exponential growths. And that's what you see in all these platforms. They have all these similar characteristics. And so that means that over time, the price of each product or each service will get very, very low. And I've been talking about this since 3.5 years, and everybody laughed, it's not going to happen in healthcare. Well, 3 weeks ago, Zebra Medical Vision in Israel, they started now to deliver their AI-based radiology scans for $1 an image as a global service. It is already happening. So radiology services for $1 for each scan. Of course, this is not a valid business model, but there is a very strong backup from Kojela Ventures, who spends their three-digit numbers of millions, and that's what Peter Diamandis from Singularity University calls the face of deception. So what you see in these startups, they at the beginning they don't earn money, they burn money, and they get hundreds of millions of money until the point they get so much data and their algorithms are getting so accurate that suddenly that product is as good as it as they say it to be. Perhaps at the moment they're still using radiologists in the background, and they're still doing a double like an algorithm and human-based diagnosis, but over time they're going to get more accurate, and then they will grow exponentially. And what you will see then, and that's what very similar to Google Search or to Amazon, you will see that there will not be a second player or a third player. You will mostly see that there will be one dominant player. And that's very scary in some sense, because then you get monopolies, and you have to just talk to Microsoft how many billions they spend in creating the second search engine, which was called Bing. Because Google had the best algorithm, everybody was going on Google because it just was convenient and you got what you were searching for. Well, imagine that you would create a radiology imaging diagnostical service and you would ask $100 and you would be less accurate. Nobody's going to buy your product. And these products are going to scale. So there will be, my prediction in 5 years, there will be, if we don't change things, just a handful of these providers. The next thing, automation. I think in ophthalmology, in diabetic retinopathy screening, automation is already happening. Another example is from AliveCor. AliveCor, they used and they started 6 years ago with an ECG two-point sensor, ECG that you could attach on your iPhone. It collected data and they were using a telemedical store and forward principle. That means you get a file, a WAV file, you send it to your cardiologist, he analyzes it and he makes a diagnosis. But at the same time in their startup phase, they were collecting data and then they were using and developing an AI that now is able to detect an atrial fibrillation in a higher accuracy as the cardiologist does. So, and it's fully automated. There's no human interaction anymore. And their product got really cheap. You can buy it for $99. Network effects. And I think one of the things we need to learn is in the platform economy how to deal with it. We all have knowledge. Everybody here, or all the university hospitals I talk to, have a specific set of knowledge that you are able to put into a form or in an algorithm. And if you create out of that algorithm a digital service, really something that you scale out, not something that you use in your house, in your organization, but you give that as a product, then you will be able to create a value that somebody will buy. And by using that system, you will get more data, and this is an infinity loop, and this is how most of these platforms work. So as soon as you create value, and you have a better value than the other, and even if it's not perfect, you will start to get usage, you will collect more data, the more data, the better your algorithm. So it's all gonna be a challenge to see, okay, how do we get that performance out of the data that we have, how do we can start using and investing more in there, and how do we grab the opportunity here that because it's not only about research anymore, because you can't detach research from digital delivery. Because if you don't scale this inner cohort of 100 million, well, then you're not going to be able to deliver that same quality of service as the others are doing that have these cohorts. Then the information asymmetry. I think AI, and Elon Musk is being very skeptical on AI, said it's the most dangerous invention that humans ever did. Well, if data data is the foundation of it, we'll decide which are the best algorithms. It will also decide which are the winners and the losers. And if we then think about, some people tell that data is a new natural resource. Well, then if I agree with that, because the natural resource in the past was oil and that was the engine for the industrial revolution, but if then data is now the engine of the new revolution, then we should learn from the geodependencies that we had from the old revolution, don't we? Because if you then talk about ethics, how much were we able to influence ethics in the Middle East where that natural resource was positioned? And I never quoted Putin, this is the first time in my life, but I think he's in some sense right. And what he did now, he says like, it's the one who leads in AI and in that technology, and you can define it on industries, you can say like the one who leads in AI and healthcare is the one who's going to lead that industry. And what Putin did now, he changed the university programs and he's really investing, or they are really investing in getting more data scientists and getting more mathematicians. They're getting the whole educational program changed. And Russia, if you look at the global Olympiad for mathematicians, China was always number one, Russia was number two, and Romania was always number three. And I think you need very skilled people. And then China, when the US played AlphaGo, because AlphaGo is a Chinese game, that was for the Chinese, or is it not a Chinese game? No? Okay, Korean.
It's Asian game.
Asian.
AlphaGo is the algorithm from the UK.
Okay, this is Go, yeah. So, but if you look at the what actually happened, that was not the point of the tool itself or the game itself, but it's what we call the Sputnik moment. So when Sputnik was the first satellite that Russia sent as a satellite across the world, that woke up the US, and then this whole a competition began, and it drove a whole industry. I think what you see now is that China announced that they want to become the world AI leader or superpower in 2030. So there is a huge geopolitical dependency here, and it's and we really have to watch out that, well, if we still want to take or deliver the same future as we were able to enjoy, and if our children need to be able to enjoy that future, we need to really rethink things. Financing, I'm always surprised how naive people are when we use specific apps that are for free, because there is always a data monetization model in mostly, and the most typical internet business models are using personal data. And they're not working as a bank where you have transaction fees and where you work you have revenues on your interest rates. An example is an exit that just took place from an Austrian startup called MySugar. MySugar has 1 million users. It's from Austria. 1 million users that actually all gave their consent because they didn't read the terms and conditions when downloading that app. But actually, in these terms and conditions, there is this clausule that always says, like, in case of a merger, acquisition, or dissolution, your personal data will be part of the assets being transferred. My life partner is a lawyer for merger and acquisition. She says this clausule is a red flag. If this is not into the terms and conditions, the privacy terms of a startup, the startup won't get acquired. That means we have no control anymore on that data as a patient. We don't, even if we want to give consent, but we are kind of forced because you have then updated the app, and then the app says probably then you need to agree with the new terms and conditions, and who pushes then no and deletes the app and reads it? But you know that situation, but nobody pushes no and doesn't delete these things. And then what actually happened with MySugar, well, it got sold to Roche, and Roche got now access to email addresses, location services of 1 million people that have diabetes. And I think this is very interesting to see what is actually happening, and if we start continuing these models, we're going to kind of destroy the trust of our patients, and this is not what digital health needs to be. I think digital health is not about monetizing on our personal data. I think there's a very other way to monetize, but then we need to have and to see more investments. So sometimes I call these startups, and not all of them, but sometimes they're like a kind of a Trojan horse. This is Babylon Health. Babylon is a symptom checker that actually you give as a patient your symptoms, and then it gives a pre-diagnosis. And I had a few hospitals that actually I was talking to, and they said, yeah, we're working with Babylon. There is the same similar solution in Germany. It's called Ada Health. And all these startups have the same clausule about personal data. But actually, the more interesting part is that they changed their business model because they used to collaborate with hospitals, and then suddenly they say, like, we don't need you anymore because we're going to do teleconsultation. So as soon as you get an indication on a specific diagnosis, we're going to match you with a physician that really matches that what you have, and we're going to serve you online. So suddenly your supplier becomes your competitor, but you gave your data away to that supplier. So. If you look at the philosophy and the ethics around it, Peter Thiel, a book that I can recommend, 0 to 1, two of the quotes out of his book, competition is for losers, and a monopoly is not a disease. Well, if these are the ethical standards of the ones who are going to deliver our healthcare systems of the future, then I'm really thoughtful. And I think we need to all together try to see how we can hack that system. because there's no ethics there on personal data. There's no ethics on where your data ends. And I think we in Europe have a very different value system when it comes to healthcare. And this is not only about simple diagnostical apps that do a symptom check, because there was a study being published from the Future of Humanity Institute, and they predicted that here the surgeon in 27 years or 30 years from now, every single surgery will be over, a robot will overperform surgeons in 30 years from now. And then there was an Oren Etzioni, a friend of mine, he posted a very funny quote in Twitter, and it says, like, Amazon Prime membership is offered to replace the US citizenship. It offers just so much more benefits, including healthcare. But in some sense, it's very humoristic. But in another sense, we really need to think of it if data is going to define who is going to have the best access to knowledge. And we're going to see these monopoles, and that's the philosophy of most of them, of these internet companies. Then we really have to be very careful on the dependencies that we create. So we need to start getting emancipated in this area, in the digital age. We need to not be afraid anymore from platforms. But we, most of all, we should not stick to our old models. If we're going to stick to the old models, we're going to be doomed. I don't like to fear as a really bad advisor, but in this sense and the evolution I see, I think we really need to look at, and this is what I'm sorry for the German here, but you need to think about what's going to happen in 10 and 30 years, and the question we need to ask is, how do we can use our systems, like our research infrastructure, our medical staff, our patients, the data, the knowledge that we have, including and based on a platform economy, but with a value system that is reflecting our European standards and can bring a better value proposition as the current providers do on the market. And I think this is the question that I'm discussing with the government in Germany, and there was just a paper being released from the Ethics Commission. I don't think the answer is to build walls and to forbid Uber and to forbid all these companies. I think we need to play along with the game, but I think we need to accelerate our investments and perhaps pre-invest instead of getting the investment through a monetization of the data. So I started doing this in Germany. So I'm going to talk a bit about two projects. So IBM is not an internet company. So we deliver platforms for our clients that are able or allow university hospitals to deliver these services, to scale them. I see the teaching hospital or the university hospital as a platform of the future. So I think if you look at a teaching hospital today, they get patients, they collect data, they do research, and they publish not in an API, but in a journal. Well, why don't publishing it at the same time into a web service and then scaling it and creating a digital service provider? I think I visited every single university hospital in Germany, and then I found Professor Scholz from the UKSH in Schleswig-Holstein. And the one question that triggered his change, because he said, like, I'm going to start and initiate a cultural change, is when I asked him the question, if his research that he publishes in 10 years is going to still be valuable research if he doesn't have a cohort that is larger than 1 million or 2 million on a specific disease, because that's what the Amazons and the others will have. And then he started realizing that data is going to be the foundation of our medical knowledge, and then we need to get our the different models, and we set up different models. So we initiated a joint innovation hub, and we started with a healthcare hackathon based on that platform. And these are three Austrian kids that flew to Schleswig-Holstein. These are both, all of them are 16 years old. And to show and demonstrate how easy and these technologies are today, they developed in 30 hours a drone can be used for mountain rescue that uses an AI image recognition service to recognize people and then drop a mechanism to have a first rescue bag being dropped. And they have an app and they developed it in 30 hours of time. We gave them a prize of 20,000 euros, and now I'm trying to push them to build that same system for having a specific camera for avalanche rescue and then looking at heat detection to find people that are under an avalanche and then motivating these kids to continue their journey. The the hospital in some sense can become what I call an exponential organization, so they can grow their revenues in terms of creating digital services themselves. So that means what we're planning with the University Hospital of Schleswig-Holstein is to create a digital service portfolio that they will own. They will have the IP rights on it. They will get the data. We don't get access on IBM to the data. And they will get and use that data for further research and creating new algorithms that they can scale. We're planning to, in the area of screening, oncology screening programs, to scale that in an area from 2.6 billion people, million people in Schleswig-Holstein. But I'm talking to the Ministry of Health to make the Klinikum suddenly a provider for whole of Germany and perhaps beyond, because that's the only way how they can survive in that future. Process that we are implementing is not only based on technology. You need to get an engagement of your patients. You need to involve your staff. What we set up is an innovation hub, and the innovation hub is separate from the organization, because mostly innovation gets killed by the immune system of the organization. They have an office at our IBM offices and externally, and they need to be creative, and it's a joint team. And the most important thing is the cultural change. So Professor Scholz and the Ministry of Health, they are initiating a cultural change. And we had in that hackathon 5,000 citizens coming over. And we had robot surgeons and everything else. And the citizens could touch and feel digital health to get the fears away. So the citizens and the population is included. And it's not about creating fears. It's about getting them closer to a digital transformation. The other thing what we're focusing on is on robot surgery. The last example that I'm going to give is a local lab in Munich. I met Professor Haverlach. He's one of the leading researchers in leukemia and hematology diagnostics. He's a hematologist from background, and he has set up the largest biobank with 500,000 cases in Munich. If you know that the prevalence of leukemia in Germany is 15,000, and he has 500,000, including longitudinal data, then he's sitting on a lot of value on that data. And then I educated him on what's going to happen in the next 10 years, and then he said to me, well, then I have a choice. Like, in 10 years from now, I can buy a sequencing tool from Illumina or from somebody else, and that sequencing tool is going to call a specific digital service, and then it's going to spit out the diagnosis and spit out the therapy, and what is my added value as a lab? I have now 300 employees. It's going to be all optimized. I don't get the data. I don't create knowledge. I'm not going to be able to publish. And I said, well, that's most probably the scenario that we will see once we're going to shift from the hematological diagnostics to genome diagnostics in leukemia. And then he said, like, well, then I want to be the leader, and I want to be that platform that everybody's going to use. So we started now with our project together with Illumina, and the first results are just going to be announced this week on the ASH conference in the US. So our goal is really to start shifting leukemia diagnostics from hematological to genome diagnostics, and then we will build for him a platform that actually will be used worldwide, and that he will get all the data, he will get the IP, and he will become a platform provider. So the thing what I wanted to communicate here and with the hospitals and with these providers is that everybody here still has a chance to become a global provider of a specific service. And it doesn't have to be a commercial company. It can also be a public institute, or it can also be a small lab with 300 employees that if he's going to succeed together with us to create that first, I call it the PayPal for leukemia diagnostics based on genome diagnostics. Illumina has 70% market share, and they have a platform called BaseSpace with an app store kind of in it. They just need to push a button, and that service is available worldwide to all the labs who have that equipment. Well, imagine if he then, and we get through the World Health Organization, a new classification, and we will be able to switch to that genome level. He will be the leader in diagnostics, and he will be the leader in his research, and that's his main goal. He's betting his whole company, his whole heritage kind of his work on this, and I think these are the examples that we need to see more in Europe, because we have a lot of very good researchers and scientists, And I think building new partnerships with the industry will help us to transform. And that's the last slide. To accelerate, and as I mentioned before, we have done that review or the survey in Germany, and 6 out of 10 didn't even know and understand what a platform economy was. So I think there needs to be a lot of educational education being done on the leaders. So we created, I created with a few friends now, a research institute which is focusing on exponential technologies, but we call desirable futures. And desirable means that it's desirable based on our European ethical standards, the standards that we want to see our children living in. And within this institute, I'm going to open in 2018 a digital health faculty, and we want to do executive training, build collaborations with other academical institutes, and embrace and try to build bridges between the technology education that we see and then the academical education in the medical space, because I think it's necessary. I think we need to start educating our leaders and educating clinicians and physicians to start jointly create a different future that is very different than a country that today perhaps doesn't serve 40 million people and has very different value sets on healthcare. So that's my drive and that's my passion. If anybody is interested in joining or in supporting or building an affiliation, you're more than welcome to connect to me. And with that, I want to thank you for your attention. And if there's any question, then I will stand here. Thank you. Any question? I don't know if I have time.
Thank you for this excellent talk. I just have a short one. What do you think is the answer to machines creating knowledge and our perception of that? So at the moment, the knowledge that is created, we still can understand. But if algorithms get faster, they establish new classifications, new diagnoses that we're not familiar with, and it's going at a very high speed. What do you think is going to happen? Do we just accept it?
No.
Is there be a revolution? Do we adapt? What do you think, how we are going to do with that?
I think the same thing as on the evolution on is a very good question, and it's related as well to black box medicine, because a lot of the algorithms are just a black box, and we can't understand why they took specific decisions and why they went to these specific new subtypes. There are first results of opening the black box, algorithms that will be able to replicate and let us understand why these decisions were being taken. So I think there will be an evolution as well that we will be able to open up the black box. That's the first answer to your question. I think the second one, I think it's not, your question had a bit of a passive element. I think it's up to us to decide that, but and that's exactly what my point was before. I think if we leave it up to countries that have very other standards, if you think about China and gene editing, if they would lead the future, then we would all get very scared, I think. But I think that's what we need to do. We need to lead, and we need to implement our standards in there. And I think it's not something that we have to be passive about.
No, I don't mean passive. You know, it's when we drive a car and we have this airbag thing, we don't think about how airbag works. We just are lucky that we have it, right?
Yes.
But someone understood at some point how it worked, and we are fine with it. That was my point.
Yeah, but I think like in the diabetic retinopathy, there is already an algorithm that can be completely automated. But then we need to publish it with studies, and it needs to be proven, and it needs to, the FDA is also very strong focusing on that shift. And once it gets approved, I think that's the other thing. But that's then there is already a proof of that. But I don't think knowledge will be in real time being created and then being implemented. That will not be the fact. Because then we are passive. I think there needs to be a control mechanism in between. Yes.
I think that it's all about quality control as well, because we already have the dilemma in science that there is a lot of wrong information, even in the publications that are in the most prestigious journals. And there's a research institute in Stanford run by John Ioannidis, who clearly stated and proved that about a third of what is published in science is correct. Another third is incorrect because of involuntary errors. And another third is just faked truth. So there are a lot of publications also, particularly coming from China, interestingly, that have to be withdrawn because it turns out that the data were not reproducible. But here, the black box, as you call it, is even darker, and it will be much more difficult to control for the truth content of data. And this is, of course, something very worrisome. And there are many algorithms, for instance, the algorithm that can tell whether a person is homosexual or heterosexual. And they have a very high precision in predicting homosexuality. Mm-hmm. But then it turned out that they took their data, the photos that they used for prediction, from a dating app. So, of course, the way how you present yourself to attract females or males is completely different. So how about avoiding these fake data and biased analysis?
Yeah, I think healthcare is very biased. I think the moment we started implementing DRGs, our complete clinical information system started to get biased because we saw suddenly different numbers on diagnoses or birth weights because you could be able to build a different DRG. So bias has been there before we even talked about algorithms. I think data always serves a specific purpose. And if data has the system and the data that we use is only as good as the purpose it was designed for. And I think we have to be very careful in what kind of data we use. I think the data that we have here from an Apple Watch or other sensors is going to be less biased and it's going to be way more standardized in terms of measuring things. We had a similar issue with the with Watson for Oncology. So we used NCCN guidelines. And there was a huge, and don't quote me on Twitter because we don't discuss this, but actually I think it's important to discuss these things. What we saw is that the community was expecting that everything what we did in Oncology Advisor is that we tap in PubMed and we read all these journals and then we create new guidelines, and that was not the case. What we have is a board of experts at Memorial Sloan Kettering that actually curates the knowledge and the data that we use for the system. So there is a data curation part, and that's at the moment something you can't eliminate. But I mentioned before, even that curation is a black box because I don't know specific interest of persons and people, and we saw that in the past as well, that if you look at in orthopedic surgery, there were specific guidelines that you knew that conservative therapy was better than a specific like cartilage shaving and the results were just different. Still, these guidelines were being published and being recommended. So it, in some sense, there is always a bias. I think it's all about creating the institutes and the organizations that we need to define to tell what actually is the lingua franca, what is the common truth. And that's going to be a very difficult challenge, but that's what I mentioned before. This is, healthcare is a bit about kingdoms of knowledge and who is then defining what really is the truth. But I agree, like if you look at China, Chinese researchers, they get an incentive. I think it's $100,000 if they get published in Nature or in some specific top journal. So there is a bias there because they get an incentive. I think there is a lot of challenges in there, but I think we already have these challenges in today's healthcare system as well. I think they just get more extrapolated and we should not completely ignore it and we should try to solve it. But I think it's something that is going to pass because our new data that we generate is going to be less biased. Is that answer your question? I don't have a specific end goal of that answer, but I think we need to all work together on controlling it. Yes, please.
Yeah, I also find it challenging with the truth. I know there's a famous example where the algorithm to determine who was high risk for pneumonia identified that people with asthma were less of a risk, their outcomes were better, and that was because the training data set a huge training data set in those particular facilities, anyone with asthma went directly to ICU, so their outcomes were better. So the algorithm correctly learned, but it was not generalizable. And I find that much more challenging to get at when there's not that many large data sets available to train and to test and to replicate. And I'm not sure how to facilitate that and to minimize those kinds of errors where that was a clear error that a good clinician realized the algorithm is wrong, but for other things that we're not as familiar with, it would be more challenging to identify those kind of errors.
Yeah, definitely. I read that book, Weapons of Mass Destruction. I don't know if you read that book. Yeah. It's a very intriguing book about all the wrong decisions if you look at imprisonment based on algorithms. I think we just should not accept an algorithm as is. I think we are still on a path to find the right way to. Data is not data. We need to find out how do we collect data. And I think when you design, and I think that's where the focus is on this. If we design new solutions that are doing a specific task, like a diagnostical purpose, and then that solution is collecting data at that same time, then the purpose of that data is really to get an accurate diagnosis. But you have to start with a specific algorithm that is based on historical data or knowledge. And so that's where you need to first perhaps get a very clean algorithm. But it's about how you design it at the end into your system. I think that's something that completely is forgotten now. It's not about the algorithm itself, but how do you then collect new data, and with that new data you perhaps adopt your algorithms, because these systems are not static. They should be always going on feedback loops and be dynamic, because if we don't get and integrate these feedback loops, we will go into a very wrong direction. I don't know if that answered your question. Yeah. Any other questions? Then I think I'm already 1 hour and 10 minutes. I think that was way over time. Thank you.